My name is Anna Bujica. I am originally from Lithuania, but I'm currently based in Denmark. I'm at the very beginning of my PhD project at the University of Aarhus, and I'm based at the Center for Urban Network Evolutions. And so in this particular paper, I've collaborated with Guru Bhakti, who's just helped me all over the lab, and so her name is absolutely up there as well. But so I am at the beginning of my project, and my idea coming here to the EAA, and my hope was to sort of share the general idea of my PhD project and to outline the methods and approaches I'm thinking about using from the purposes and sort of ask for input from you and ask you if you have any recommendations for methods or literature that you found particularly useful in the past with some sort of subjects. And so my project essentially focuses on defining the regional variability of iron smelting slag from 7th to 10th century East Africa. And so the material itself is obviously not the most glamorous of all, but I've had the fortune to work in these amazing places. And all throughout the presentation, you will be seeing these images that we took during this year's fieldwork, and they're there for you to go to happier place if you don't have to. And so let me just say a few words about the region itself. East Africa is very unique in the African continent in general. And all along the eastern coast, down from Somalia onto Kenya, Tanzania, and then onto Mozambique a little bit. There's this unique ethnic group of people called Swahili. And so nowadays there's obviously a lot of cultural variation in the region. But what they still have in common, for example, is the Swahili language. But so the historical interpretation behind the origins is that the Bantu people who lived in the Western and Sub-Saharan Africa moved or migrated towards the east of the continent, that's Kenya and Somalia, and then down along the coast, and down along the Victorian Lakes region, also bringing the iron smelting technology from the Western Sub-Saharan Africa. That was in the early Iron Age. And so, not long after that, the people who have settled the coast started creating trade connections with the Arabian Peninsula and India and China and the Persian Gulf and eventually European traders. And so, a big part of creating those trade connections included adopting Islam as a main religion and adopting Arab words and incorporating Arab words into the language, and including Persian merchants and Arab merchants moving to the region and intermarrying with people. That obviously transformed the landscape quite a lot. And so there's been a temptation from archaeological perspective to look at these imported artifacts, to look at the glamorous material that sort of has these Islamic and imported sort of character to it. And so a lot of what's happening right now in African archaeology is moving from focus from imported to looking from glamorous to this indigenous craftsmanship and understanding better the technology of the region. And so that's sort of where my research fits in the region. And so far I've been able to make arrangements to get material from 6 different sites in the East Africa, and then you can see them sort of plotting the map. And so one is in the hinterland in the Pavia on the coastal area. And so the fundamental idea behind this project was, given this one area in East Africa, well, we know a fair amount about international trading, but in terms of what's going on within the coast itself and trading between the coastal sites and the hinterland in particular, we're not quite sure what was going on. And so given this region, and use examples of iron slag and iron ore and a range of sites along the coast, can we devise a database and a set methodology that would sort of help us understand how iron moved in the coast and potentially between the hinterland and the coast? And so if you've ever come across, or if you haven't had a chance to sort of dip into the literature about iron provenance, you will notice that at the moment it's a very specific task. Last year, a paper came out by Charlton who summarized it very well. Well, a little bit pessimistically, but I argue rather sort of spot on, saying that iron provenance studies have languished in a perpetual stage of method development. And so, a lot of what I will be doing is feeding into that stage of method development in my research. But it will be feeding into it rather than sort of focusing or making that the focus of my research. because soon after we started thinking about the methods that we're using, the approaches that we'll be using to sort of feed into those questions, it became apparent that that's not necessarily the most pressing question to be answered about iron smelting technologies in East Africa. And so iron working on the coast has been studied relatively well, yet we don't have a coherent understanding of the smelting and smithing practices. And individual sites and ethnographics or studies have don't necessarily give us a wholesome data set that would enable a cross-site comparison of technological aspects involved in ancient iron smelting. And so one of the questions that I will be looking to answer in my research is, can we, looking at elemental composition and microstructure of iron slag, can we reverse engineer the manufacturing process and identify the raw materials that went into the production of iron? And so another question is standardization. To what extent production was standardized? Was each smelting event ever so slightly different from another in terms of temperature, furnace, sort of construction and raw materials used for it? Or was it consistent within the site? And then does each site have its own sort of unique technological signature for smelting iron? And is that sort of technological know-how isolated to each site? Or are they sharing that knowledge? Can we see some like synonymous smelting practices all over the coast? And so at the moment I have 20 to 30 samples from two of the six sites that I mentioned. And one of them is called Akawa. And so the Akawa is very interesting to us because it is a smelting site in the hinterland. That was and it was excavated in 1993. And the general consensus is that there was quite a bit of trading between the coast and the hinterland, because we do find a lot of Swahili material in the hinterland, and particularly in the Akawa. But we do tend to think about that trade as between the hinterland and the coast and not going into this individual site resolution. So it's very exciting for us to have the Akawa as an example and to meet that sort of high definition of archaeology. And so the other site is called Kilwa. Now, Kilwa was one of the most prosperous sites on the coast, and it persevered well into the second millennium AD, up until the Portuguese arrived in the region. It was around 16th century, I believe. And so some of the slag in this site is mainly in a slag heap that's sort of just visible walking through the site and situated on the outcrop of lateral ore. And the problem with that is that it's not stratigraphically sort of positioned, and we don't know the dates without dating each individual sample through right radiocarbon dating. And so for the purposes of this presentation and for the purpose of illustrating what I'm going to do, I've not yet had a chance to radiocarbon date we're making arrangements for that right now. But so for the purpose of being here, we've sort of selected just samples that are potentially from the earlier stages, and we went ahead and analyzed them. But it could be could well be that we're like the region, the differences in elemental composition that we've seen, they're more due to the chronological differences from these sites between these sites rather than due to the regional differences. And so what I'm starting to do right now is to look at the major elements and the ratios. And I've sectioned and polished each sample and I'll analyze them using Ruka microxera. To obtain quantitative information of elemental distribution on 2 to 3 areas of your sample. And those areas, depending on the porosity of the samples, range anything from a few hundred micrometers to a few thousand micrometers. Because I find that as soon as you start analyzing areas that are rather porous, the trace and the minor elements just have a very high quantitative value. And so a big part of the next step is to go through the various different approaches that have been used in the past and have worked for other authors and figure out what works for me and what doesn't. And so as an example, on slide is I followed the method that Painter used in the publication that came out in 2006 and selected the elemental ratios that work particularly well in that publication and sort of tried to replicate and see how well that works for mine. And from the first slide, it's sort of apparent that we can see definite or fairly well-pronounced regional variation. And particularly in the left column, where we're comparing manganese and phosphorus and the magnesium and potassium oxides, and so the clusters seem to be fairly well separated. The problem with that is, there are a couple of problems. So first of all, we only have 4 samples in total. So 2 samples from each site, and the whole image could be completely reversed by the analysis of a couple more samples. And another problem, I'd argue, is that the instrument we were using has detection limits of 0.5%. And so all the elements that seem to be particularly useful are falling under that. And that is also indicating the quantity of those elements. But that is, and it's encouraging to see them clustering like that. But it is sort of indicating that we need to move on to the more quantitatively adequate techniques like acid elements. And similarly looked at the ratios of buckled in a paper published in 2005, found useful, and we can come to some of the conclusions that the differences in ratios are a source of inspiration for other studies, and particularly to look at traits and methods. And one thing that does fall out is that the samples from Kilburn were presented with this green bluish color. They tend to cluster fairly consistently, whereas the samples from the Kawa Matthews were brown color. They have a broad spread in the chart. And this could probably be better seen in the tenure backgrounds, where again, blue spots are Kilwa and brown spots are the cow. And so we have a lot of more variation in terms of island weight percentages in the cow samples, and that sort of immediately begs the question, what does that mean in terms of standardization of production and in terms of efficiency of production? Because on the one hand, we have the power where the weight percentage of iron varies anything from 60-something to 80%, 80 weight percentage, and that seems, on the one hand, indicating very non-standardized production, that each smelting episode is different from the other, and it's indicating the lack of efficiency in the process, because if we have this much iron left in the slag, that's obviously pointing towards inferior smelting practice, whereas in Kilwa, the iron percentage is consistent, and that sort of makes us think that the smelting technology was consistent and standardized, and it was a lot more efficient than the Kilwa. But then again, is that a reflection of regional differences, or is that a reflection of temporal differences and volume and smelting practices? And so, as you can see, I have a long way to go before any meaningful conclusions can be made, but hopefully you will agree that this inspires a lot of optimism and this sort of a source of inspiration to do further work on this. And if you have any thoughts or suggestions now, or feel free to find me during the breaks, I will appreciate your help. Thank you.